because we are here. We come this morning, Lord, help us to shut the world out and just be here to worship you and to praise you and to bow before you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, totally and complete, perfect in absolutely everything that you do. How can we not but worship you? So this morning, Lord, we lift our voices in praise, we lift our hearts unto you in adoration, and we bow in our hearts also before you, as we are now before the throne of God, and the angels of God are gathered all around. Holy Spirit, have your way here this morning as we proclaim the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. As it comes to a new time, we have a new song. The song is called Nobody by Casting Crowns. It is an uplifting song, and it was a song that would fit well for this day. But seeing we're not quite up yet, Jess, okay, then I'm handing it over to Jessica.
Why you ever chose me has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line with all the other not quite, with all the never get it right. But it turns out they're the ones you were looking for all this time. 'Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
When Moses had stage fright and David brought a rock to a sword fight, you picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. Well, the moral of the story is everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me, saying, who do you think you are? I say,
I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
So let me go down, down, down in history as another blood-bought faithful member of the family. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. So let me go down, down, down in history.
Go down in history.
Has another blood bought faithful member of the family.
That's all I ever want to be.
And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. I'm living for the world.
Just a nobody,
nobody
trying to tell everybody all about somebody.
Ooh,
who saved my soul.
Save my soul.
Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Nobody but Jesus.
Okay.
Why you ever chose me has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong.
Okay. Please join me in the call to worship. The Lord is the light and my salvation. The Lord is the stronghold of my faith. And lifts me up and sets me high on a rock. Before we go to the Lord in unison prayer, please join me. Oh God, we cry to you. Help us to worship you and to consecrate our thoughts on you. We cannot do this alone. In us there is darkness, but with you there is light. We are lonely, but you do not leave us. We are feeble, but you are there to help. We are
understand your ways, but you know the way for us. Before you, before one another. Lord, whatever these days and years have been, your name be praised. Amen.
Please hear these words of assurance. Jesus calls us back again and again to the fullness of fellowship with him, forgiving our sins and loving us into allegiance. This is our assurance and the wondrous joy of a membership in Christ's family. Praise be to our God. Please join in the Gloria Patri. Do we have this day any upper room moments or testimonies to share this morning? Or any praises or thanksgivings? Very true. Anything else this morning? The upper rooms are in. If you don't have one, please pick one up in the back. Okay? I know there's a lot of times when they just kind of touch. So, okay. Testimony, we have had a wedding here yesterday. It was amazing to see all the family and the friends and the members of the families be together. And it was a time of joy, celebration. So, church has been busy lately with lots of things going on. But there's also a lot of praise and worship and thanksgiving unto the Lord God Almighty. So, it is a good thing. Tired, but it is a good thing. So, I agree with Roxanne. It seems like it's been a long time since we've had church. So it's good to be back together this morning. So, anything else this morning that you need to share? Okay. Our lesson this morning is taken from Acts 5. And I have the wrong one, so I'll have to go then. Okay. I'll have to use my Bible for a change. How about it? So it will not, men, it will not go along with the Pew Bible, so be aware of that. So we are back, we are still in Acts because the story is just being told and laid out. You know, it's a long story, and I agree with that, that it is a long story, but it's a very important story. Because we start in Acts 5:16 is where I'm going to begin at today. We left off with Peter, and we left off with people coming and laying people in the street before him, and as they laid them down, just a shadow of him would walk across and would bring healing and healed all of them. And so were there. Also a multitude gathered from the surrounding cities to Jerusalem, bringing sick people and those who were tormented by unclean spirits, and they were all healed. Now we get the high priest in there, and all those that are supposed to be wise in the characters of God and what God is all about. And they have the rule, they have their authority, and they have their place. But in their heart, theirs is the only one that matters. All their rituals, all their traditions have to be done their way and in a right way. Otherwise, it's not included. It doesn't count. So the disciples were not doing it their way. And they were afraid that the disciples and the name of Christ would draw away from their congregation and away from their history. And so they put up this protective mode that we're going to get Jesus no matter what. And they did. And now what's left is his disciples. The high priest rose up and those who were with him, which is a set of Sadducees. And they were filled with indignation. They just despised them. It wasn't just that they didn't like them. They were beginning to despise them. They laid their hands on the apostles and put them in a common prison. They just picked them up and threw them in jail. They didn't know what else to do with them. That was almost a safety hold to them because the people already know what the apostles did and the healing that was there, so they had to hold them someplace. So where do you hold them? You throw them in jail. Well, does that kind of change people's attitude about you, that you are now a prisoner in a jail? Are you not being put out there again that, wait a minute, he was in jail, you know, and now he's out here? But with God, jail doesn't touch you a bit. So we have to watch here and see what the Lord's hand is in this, totally and completely. But at that night, the angel of the Lord came into that jailhouse, and he opened the prison doors, and he brought them all out. All of the disciples that were in there, they all came out and told them. And when you get direction from the angel, you best do what the angel's telling you to do. He didn't tell them to go and hide. He did not. He sent them to the last place we would think they would want to be at. He sent them back to the temple. Go stand in the temple, speak to the people all the words of this life, of your life. Take that word with you. And when they heard that, where did they go? They went directly to the temple early in the morning. They were told, if we remember correctly, that they were not to preach the name of Christ. They were not to use his name, especially in the temple. They were not to use his name. So who came along? That's where they went, to the high priest and those he came, called the council together with the elders of the children of Israel, and they wanted to find out about the prison, to go to the prison. But when the officers came and did not find them in the prison, they returned and reported, saying, "Indeed, we have found the prison shut securely, The doors are still locked, all of them. And the guards are standing outside. But when we opened them, we found absolutely no one inside. How did they get out? You got to have the guards standing out there scratching their head and saying, where did they go? We were here all night. There's only one door in and out of this place. What happened here? Even if the Pharisees and the Sadducees don't believe, the guards know that something extraordinary went on in this place. Now when the high priest and the captain of the temple and the chief priest heard these things, they wondered what the outcome would be. So one came and told them, saying, look, look, the men whom you put in prison are standing in the temple and teaching people. The last place that they want them to be. And the disciples were not timid. They went and they proclaimed. Then the captain went with officers and brought them without violence, for they feared the people, lest they should be stoned. And when they had brought them, they set them before the council again. How many times now have they been before the council? How many times have they confused the council because they don't know what to do with them anyway? The prison didn't work very well if they got out on their own or whoever let them out. Okay, now we're going to find something else, what we're going to do with them. And the high priest asked them, did we not strictly command you not to teach in this name? And you can bet when he said that disgustingly. And he wanted their attention. Listen here, didn't we tell you? You are not to preach in that name. You are not to teach in that name. That's what we told you. And look, you have filled all of Jerusalem with your doctrine and intend to bring that man's blood on us. So many times we've heard them deny over and over again that they had nothing to do with the death of Jesus Christ. Are they not the ones that took him out and crucified him? And so he reminds them again. But Peter and the other apostles answer, we ought to obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus. You murdered by hanging him on a tree. How many times do they have to hear that before they truly believe that? That it was their fault that Jesus Christ is dead. And yet they keep going, that they are not going to admit that. Him God has exalted to the right hand to be Prince and Savior, and to give repentance to Israel, to all of Israel, for the forgiveness of sins. And we are his witnesses to these things. So also is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. We are the witnesses, as Peter and them are the witnesses. We are the witnesses to the whole world of what God has done to forgive our sins. And I don't know if they flinched at all when Peter says the forgiveness of all of Israel is possible through Jesus Christ, and only through Jesus Christ. In their minds, they have been killing animals for slaughter over and over again, and bringing them in and putting the blood upon the lamb and sending the lamb or the goat off out amongst them, and that was their forgiveness of sins. It was only temporary. This was the forgiveness of sins, and yet they were not interested. They were not interested. They have to protect what they have. We can see that so many times in our own lives, when we have traditions that we've always kept up, when we have ways that we've always done things. It's hard to change. It is hard to change, but especially when it's the core. How would we feel if somebody came here and said, we're locking your doors? You cannot speak the name of Christ anymore. You cannot. You are disrupting the whole world with your speech. And we are locking your doors. Would we go out and proclaim the name of Christ more? Because let's face it, this is only a building. Christ lives within us. And the disciples knew that. That it didn't make a difference what you're telling us, that we can't speak anymore. You are not our God. We only serve one God. And that's it. So he says, and we are his witnesses of these things, and so also the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. And when they heard this, they were furious, and they plotted to kill them. Not only did they kill Jesus, they were plotting to kill all the disciples. Then one in the council stood up, a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, held in respect by all the people, and he commanded them to put the apostles outside for a little while. And he said to them, "Men of Israel, take heed to yourselves what you intend to do regarding these men. For some time ago, Thaddeus rose up, claiming to be somebody. A number of men, about 400, joined him. He was slain, and all who obeyed him were scattered and came to nothing. After this, a man named Judas of Galilee rose up in the days of the census and drew away many people after him. He also perished, and all who obeyed him were dispersed. And now I say to you, keep away from these men and let them alone. For if this plan is the work of men, it will come to nothing. But if it is of God, you cannot overthrow it, lest you even be found to fight against God." Was it a plan of God? We're still here. Even though Christ was slain upon the tree, it just cemented it in deeper into our hearts and our minds and our souls. And we are still here. So we definitely can say this was the plan of God all along, to come into the hearts and minds of people in our age, in our time. And we are still the ones that are sent to tell the message, over and over again. And they agreed with him. And when they had called for the apostles and beaten them, they commanded that they should not speak again in the name of Jesus. Didn't go very far. And he let them go. So they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing in that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. And in daily in the temple and at every house, they did not cease the teaching and the preaching Jesus as the Christ. We are sometimes worried when persecution comes. We're not really ready and willing for that to happen. And I understand that. We all understand that. None of us want to stand up and be beaten. None of us want to stand up and be thrown in jail. One of us, we protect ourselves, we protect our families. It's kind of a normal instinct inside of us. But yet, when the disciples were beaten, they counted as joy. That's hard for us to understand, because that they were worthy enough. They were worthy enough for that, to be a follower after Jesus Christ. I think of all of those that have laid down their life for Christ, that were not afraid to back away. They probably were afraid in their hearts, but yet they knew deep down within them they could not deny Christ. They could not. The disciples could not deny what they had seen, what they had heard. If we look, they were a ragtag band that was with Jesus for 3 years, common, ordinary people. They had no boldness back there, only to fight, maybe, for their own property or for their own place. But this fight was different. This fight was about Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and the Son of the living God. This was a game changer, a life changer. This was one is, where is our life at? We sing the song this morning, and I love that song because we've got a story to tell. We've got a story to tell. And eventually, it might end up in our world that we are thrown in prison. But can we continue to keep our eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ, knowing that no matter if we're in prison, or no matter if we are beaten, or no matter even if we die, that our life is still in Jesus Christ? None of that has changed that. Not at all. It has not changed what our goal is. And our goal is to live in heaven one day with Jesus Christ, to see Him face to face. And He counts us worthy, even when we don't think we are worthy. He counts us worthy to carry that cross, to carry that message. And He showers upon us His presence, no matter where. The other day, as I was driving, and I know that we've been talking about the Holy Spirit and speaking in tongues, and we've not done that a lot in this church or explained a lot about speaking in tongues one way or the other. But in my own private prayer time, I do speak in tongues. And so sometimes we want to know, how do you know that God is talking to you? You know, what are you doing? But the other day I was driving just down the road, and I did not plan to speak in tongues at all. Was not in my mind whatsoever. And it just came out flowing, and it surprised the daylights out of me. I don't know what the prayer was, but it needed to be there for somebody or something. And I can rest in that. But it still surprised me. That's what Christ does with our life. He doesn't leave us where we're at when we came to know Him. He says, I got a plan for you. A plan not to harm you, but a plan to bless you. A plan that you also touch other people's lives. The disciples touched many lives over and over again. And believe me, I'm still asking the Lord God to bring back all the full gifts of the Holy Spirit. Every single one of them. So we have all the equipment that we need to work with to go and not be afraid, but also to go even when we hear. Even when we hear, you cannot preach or teach in the name of Christ. That has to rise up within us, those words. You can't stop me. We are the only ones that can stop ourselves. But the man outside of us, they cannot stop us from praising and worshiping and proclaiming and telling others the blessedness of being in the family of God and serving the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank You. We thank You for counting us worthy to carry the cross. We thank You for making us worthy to sing praises and glory and hallelujahs unto Your name. We thank You for making us worthy to proclaim the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, who has touched each and every one in here this day and those that are watching by camera. The Lord Jesus Christ stands with you. at this moment in time, the peace and the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and the Holy Spirit fill you, anoint you, and teach and lead. We pray this all in the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. I would ask you to turn in your hymnals to 452. My faith looks up to thee. Jane, give me a hymnal, songbook. Ron Keller is going in for knee surgery, so we will please keep him in prayer. A blessing for John and Rachel for their wedding and the days that was. So, and let's pray also for August 1st that we'll have a gathering in the park. So, okay. Anything else this morning that we need to pray for? Do we have anything to thank him for? What? Yes! Isn't it amazing when we pray here for rain and during that week sometime we get rain? So sometimes it's not a whole lot, but it's rain. So thank you, Lord. Anything else this morning? Okay. All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we come before you, and I need to say this, Lord, that we come in unity. We come together as apostles came together in one accord, in agreement. Even though we do not know what the other person is praying when they pray in silently, Lord, We stand together with him as the body of Christ. And we thank you, O Lord, for hearing our prayers. So it asks, take this moment of time and speak with the Lord. Heavenly Father, we praise and thank you for hearing all of our prayers all at the same time. We don't know how you do that, but we know that you do, and that's where we stand. We stand with you. We come before you this morning for the needs, Lord. We ask that you will be with Ron Keller as he goes for knee surgery. We ask, Lord, that you will just watch over the surgeons, that they do everything correctly and rightly. But we ask, Lord, that thy healing touch be upon Ron as he goes in, that he will feel your presence there, O Lord, that you will just watch over and keep him, and that his return back will go well, O Lord. It is a journey, but we ask you to be with him and his wife and family, O Lord. For that we thank you. We do thank you for John and Rachel and the wedding yesterday, Lord, and your blessings upon them and their family. So much celebration. And you know what weddings are like at Cana. So thank you, Lord. We ask the Lord for worship at the park, that you just organize it all, O Lord, that we can touch hearts and proclaim the message of Jesus Christ as Peter and John and all the disciples went exactly where you sent them, Lord. And the message was heard. So, Lord, we ask that you will open doors and windows of houses that they might hear the word and be touched totally and completely by you in that presence there. For we thank you. We pray for all of those that are camping, O Lord, that you watch over and keep them. Lord, we do thank you and praise you for the rain that you sent upon this land. The flowers are standing taller. The grass is a little greener. But there are so many more places, Lord, that need it so desperately bad. And so do we, Lord. So we continue to ask you and we continue to thank you for watering your land here, for watering your land at other places around our nation, O Lord. And we know right now that California and all of those are in really tough shape with high heat, O Lord. So we ask for your sweet, sweet rain there also. And for this we thank you. And we still pray, Lord, for those that are in Florida that are still mourning loved ones that they do not exactly know where they are. We ask that you bring comfort and send others to comfort them also in that. And now, O Lord, as you have taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we will... Does anybody want to be anointed with oil this morning for prayer? Okay. All right. At this time, we have our gifts and our offerings.
Why you ever chose me has always been a mystery. All my life, I've been told I belong at the end of the line. Will all the other not quite? Will all the never get it right?
asking for all this time. 'Cause I'm just a nobody, trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing.
Heavenly Father, with humble hearts, we offer these gifts unto you. With humble hearts, we offer ourselves unto you also, O Lord, that you will use both mightily the gift in us to proclaim the message of Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus, in your name we pray. Amen. Okay. Oh, that's right. Sorry, Beth. Okay. Birthday?
Happy birthday to you. A happy birthday to you. May you feel Jesus every day of the year. Happy birthday to you. A happy birthday to you.
Okay. Please turn in your hymnals to our last song. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, as we go this day, send us forth with your words, with your strength, and with your courage. Let us be the ones that you are sending out, like Peter and the rest, O Lord. And let your words to us be to us. Go and tell and teach and preach in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The grace of the Lord be upon you to fill you, to touch you, to lead you and guide you as you proclaim the name of Jesus Christ. Go in his name and in his courage, for he is with you. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Hallelujah and amen. God bless.